Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's
episode. I'm a real old by morning, up from San Antonio. Everything that I've got is just in this apartment. Well, their sun is high in that Texas sky. I'll be bucking at the county fair. I'm in Austin forever. I'm in Austin if you care. Ladies and gentlemen, the pigeon has landed. We've landed, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, listen, still getting things tied down. Okay, look, we're making adjustments on the studio, the podcast, everything changing. A little tired in my voice, but listen, ladies and gentlemen, there's a couple things that you can always depend on. Death, taxes, and that a podcast episode drops every fucking Monday and Wednesday, no matter what. The show goes on like Bill O'Reilly. Fuck it, I'm gonna do it live. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Last episode, some people sad, people hitting me up because the Puerto Rican pigeon had left. Some people, I didn't know you were moving. I've been talking about it in the goddamn podcast for 6 goddamn months. We did it, all right? Listen, shout out to everybody who made it a point to stop by and say goodbye. Some of those who just reached out and asked how things were, and all of that. Shout out to everybody. And listen, it's a little telling when some people don't show up. When some people don't say a word, it's kind of telling. And you know what? Fuck them. I moved out of that state. I'm moving out of some people's lives. Am I bitter? Nah, I'm just moving on, baby. At the end of the day, Kemp. I keep it moving, pimping. Okay. At the end of the day, keep it moving. The Puerto Rican pigeon, we made it. We crossed 4 states in one day, or we were in 4 different states in one day. It's kind of crazy. 2 days, drove to Texas. Bam. Thank you, ma'am. I could keep going with these pigeons puns, and I flew here in 4 days. It gets a little repetitive after a while. But listen, 4 days. 4 states. See, your boy needs some sleep. Still adjusting the time change, the humidity. I saw a goddamn armadillo outside my apartment today. Okay, was out on the balcony looking at. Got a beautiful view. Beautiful view of greenery. Looks like Africa. Saw a goddamn armadillo while I was drinking my coffee. It doesn't get more Texas than that. Waking up in the morning and seeing a goddamn armadillo outside your apartment. And I'm sorry for cursing, saying goddamn. I say goddamn, not goddamn, okay? Goddamn. Listen, I'm here in the Bible Belt now. The devil's real down here, and God's real, okay? And you got to get right with both of them. I don't know what that means, but listen, I saw an armadillo take off across the shrubbery, and I said, wow, that's a weird-looking cat. And then I said, nah, that's a weird-looking possum. And then I said, holy shit, that looks like a goddamn pig fucked a possum. Oh my God, that's a goddamn armadillo. And what did we do? I ran inside to grab my binoculars to get my peepers on them, magnified peepers on them. Armadillo didn't see it again. It was gone. Out of existence and out of my world. It was fleeting for the first time. And now I'm just on a hunt to see another goddamn armadillo. Okay, listen, I don't know if you know this about me, but your boy likes animals. And what do I like more than animals? Exotic animals. And what's more exotic than a goddamn armadillo? Okay. How many people can even really say they've seen them in their life except at a goddamn zoo? I don't even know if I've ever even seen one at a zoo. Okay. But listen, we're here. We're touched down. Obviously, if you can tell by the setup, I just threw this together for you guys. Okay. This is not the temporary podcast setup. It looks like I'm podcasting from goddamn SeaWorld right now, like I'm underwater or I'm someone who uses a weird Skype background, those Zoom calls where people try to escape the reality and they're like, look, I'm underneath in the ocean. I'm swimming. I hate everybody who pretends they're a goddamn fish on Skype. Okay. Everybody who gets on there and they put like a water background and they're like, I'm swimming. Shut the fuck up. All they see is bloop, the call ends. I'm sorry. I'm coming in hot. This is Texas Evan. Okay. Texas Evan comes in a little hot. You know what I hate though? Listen, I'm not from here. I love to joke around. I got a buddy who's lived here for quite a few years now. And I love sending pictures of things and different things. And I'd be like, don't worry about it. It's a Texas thing. Like, you know, when you go somewhere new and you pretend like you're so part of that culture now. But I hate when people go to a new place and they're just like, I'm an Austinite. I'm officially an Austinite. That's the dumbest thing ever. I hate when people just adapt and they just think they're part of it now. I know. Listen, I gotta keep my head down, and I just gotta earn it, Coach. You know, you gotta kind of just accept where you're at. You know, it's like the person who starts boxing the very first day, and then they go home, and then they're like just only talking in Muhammad Ali quotes, or someone who signs up for their first karate class, and then they go home, and they're like a 14-year-old kid, and they're just like, hey, Dad, listen, I just want to let you know you have 100 pounds on me and you've pushed me through the goddamn drywall before, but take a look at these dogs, okay? I put my dukes up. You should probably take a picture of them for evidence, because if you ever put your fucking hands on me again, I'm killing you with these things. Death strikes all day. These are registered weapons now. If you're wondering what that sound is when I move around, your boy doesn't even have a chair, okay? Your boy doesn't even have a chair yet, all right? I'll be honest with you guys. Some things didn't make it on the trip. My desk, sadly, it didn't make it. The very last second, listen, I made a rule. Everything that fits in my goddamn truck with the camper shell on it and whatever I can tie down on top, that's what's making the trip. Some things didn't make it. My desktop didn't make it. Okay, I got a college kid's beer pong table with his name inscribed on it. Shout out to him. He was a nice feller. Okay, he had that Midwest charm. Okay, I got off OfferUp a beer pong table, which is just a picnic table, you know, a folding table for $10. That's what we're casting off right now with the pod. But as that's the way things go. That's how you have appreciation, is when, you know, you just got to earn it, Coach. And we got some things in the works. Obviously, we're just going to keep evolving, baby. We're just going to keep getting better. I don't know why I feel like I'm whispering right now, but it has something to do with the fact that everything echoes in here right now where I'm at. But yeah, we're here. Some things didn't make the trip, and that's fine. And we're going to figure it out. The trip was a bit intense. It was crazy, man. We were packing, me and my fiance, and thank God for my goddamn family. I say goddamn a lot now. Texas Evan just drops them goddams all day. Thank God for my parents, my sister, her fiance. They came out, they helped us. We wouldn't have gotten it done in time, just me and my fiance. We would have just, been there and been like, well, I guess we're not going to Texas. But we got everything stuffed tighter than a can of sardines, okay? And it was nuts. Things tied down on top. It was just, and dude, the wind driving from California to Texas, holy shit. We were facing like 45 miles per hour winds the entire trip. I'm just white knuckling it, okay? And I'm driving this truck with everything tied down and just the weight in it. Just getting bullied by semis and shit. Probably killed at least 2,000 bugs on the way here. But it is what it is. Casualties happen, okay? But we put in probably took us about 15 hours that first day of driving to make it to El Paso. I passed through all the states, okay? Bam, California. Bam, Arizona. Bam, New Mexico. Bam, Texas. All in one day. It's a weird feeling. And you know who the real MVP is? Beowulf, my dog. My dog's a real MVP. She handled the drive well. She just, most of the trip, because she couldn't really get comfortable in the back seat, she just sat there and was just like, when is this fucking car ride gonna end? Because I can't explain to her, you know? She ain't shit right in a week with all the changes, all right? I need to figure that out. I think now she's realizing we're settling in somewhere, because it's like dogs know when you're moving or something's happening, like something's changing. And probably we started packing things maybe a month and a half ago. you know, like really started putting things away and boxes out. And then things just started disappearing. We lost our couch probably, and I mean, sold it. I lost it to someone for currency 3 weeks before we moved, which is like happy to get it out of the way. But also it's like, we don't have a couch for 3 weeks. And then we lost a table, and then it's just like meals were eaten on bed, you know? And Beowulf was probably like, what the fuck is happening? And then those last few days when we're really packing, she's used to seeing me with luggage and then getting sad because she's like, oh, fucking Evan's going somewhere. He's going to go, are you going off with your horse? Because, you know, sometimes I'll come back smelling like another dog. And she's like, you off with your horse, aren't you? And she probably thought that for like she was just going to get abandoned because as the apartment got more and more empty, she got more and more like on edge. And then she just didn't eat the entire trip. And probably two days before leaving, she just drank water and just stared at us like a goddamn psychopath. But the whole trip, she didn't eat. We stayed in a hotel with her. She didn't eat. She just drank a shit ton of water, pissing, you know, had to make a few piss stops for her. But she was just like, where the fuck are we going? And I love it. I love seeing like when dogs like look out the window and they're really just taking it all in. I'm just like, yeah, you're just blowing your goddamn mind right now, huh? I always bring it up that she was found in a goddamn trash can dog. And I'm like, that's a trash can dog that's crossed over 4 states in one day now. Bars, you know, traveling dog bars. But overall, the trip was good. We did, like 14, 15 hours in the first day. Probably about 8 or 9 the second day, which was rough because we hit like the time change and then you lose 2 hours. And then not only that, we had to be at our complex by 6 p.m. So we had to be up early and make that drive. And then we hit traffic. There was an accident. And I got to the complex where I had to get the keys and be able to move in. At 6:01, they stayed open, you know, because they were texting me at like 5 something, like, hey, are you going to be here? And I'm like, I'm trying. And then I was able to make it 6:01. Whew, victory, you know. I probably did that last day 5 hours without stopping. I think four, because I had to get gas. It was like 4 hours without stopping. And that shit was rough, okay? But it was good. We made it here. Overall, Texas, dope. Haven't really seen much. Listen, the apartment looks like someone has a swap meet going on. Like it's a flea market. That's what it currently looks like. Just, you know, the thing that I have seen, I'll be honest with you. Listen, people in, I don't know if it's just a Texas thing or a Midwest thing. HEB Plus, Google it. I've heard about this. HEBs, they're so cool. You know, our realtor was like, oh, you're right down the street from an HEB Plus. It's awesome. I'm like, okay, how cool can a grocery store be? Listen, HEB Plus, I don't even know how to describe it. It is more than just a grocery store. It is like Whole Foods meets Walmart meets Costco, that meets Charlie Brown's. Shout out to people who knew who Charlie Brown's is or what Charlie Brown's is, the obscure novelty store in Little Rock, California. But it's just, it has everything you can think of. There's a goddamn jewelry store in there. And oh, you know what? And it's like a twist of Vallarta because Vallarta has some random ass shit in there. Vallarta has like dresses. Okay. You ever been to a Vallarta? They got pig feet, they got chicken feet. I remember one time I was shooting a music video and I wanted some kind of animal head on the platter. And I just remember I wanted like weird things on this food platter to contrast all the good stuff that I had. I don't know if you ever saw it. It got flagged on Instagram or on YouTube for violence. What was it called? Love Song. Okay, if you Google it, a lot of times you can't even find it. But I wanted this contrast. The idea for the music video was like, it was going to be this very dreamlike state. The whole first verse was amazing, in love with this girl. the whole second verse is me finding out she's cheating on me or something, and it just completely flips. But on the dinner table, there's candy, everything's perfect, all this stuff. But there's a platter with pig feet and catfish on it, raw, just to like put this different element on it. Artistic AF, okay? But I remember I went to Vallarta and I went to the back and I asked him, I'm like, hey, what, you got any other animal parts back there? Because I wanted like pig feet and everything. These motherfuckers brought out a goddamn cow head. Just the cow head. I was like, what is that doing back there? Like they're butchering it back there, I guess. But, and I asked him, I was like, well, how much is that? And thinking back, I should have went with the cow head because that's so, it's such a novelty, but it's a little bit much. All right. But the guy, I remember he looked at it and he was like, $80. You know, he like just threw out a number. And I was just like, no, I'm already over budget for this goddamn shoestring music video. So I left it. But I just always thought that was crazy about Vallarta, that like everything's for sale here. They sell soccer balls and shit. That's racist. But yeah, so we made it here. HEB Plus, that's what I was talking about. It's the dopest place. They got like everything you can think of. Everything. Anything you think of. You're like, oh, well, Evan, can I buy a tent there? Yeah, you can. You can buy a nice little cooler. They got, you know, grills, barbecues. They got everything you can think of. So much stuff. And they have a lot of like weird novelty items that are dope. Like certain restaurants, refried beans and like bags that you can buy. It's like ready for you to use. They got a restaurant in there, the Flaming Bird. I'll be honest. I got it. It wasn't that good. I got it at the end of the day though. So maybe it was like the last chicken they had. But I got to be honest with you guys. Listen, a lot of people think that, oh, it's like you move to a new place. It's magical. It's amazing. It's so much better than the place you just came from. The experience so far, and I haven't really gone into Austin that much, it's not necessarily better. I love the location I live at, but the food, especially, I've gone to a few places, not the best yet, okay? I need to find, I'm sure they're out there. Just like there's places in California that you just don't go, there's places probably here that you just don't go. That's not where the real stuff is. So I'm still on the search for the best barbecue, you know, things like that. I got to be honest with you. My apartment complex, it's really nice. It's got a lot of great amenities. Some people, you know, I went to Costco here, not that friendly. People were kind of rude. People were kind of, you know, they always talk about how people from California are so rude and all this stuff. And I'm like, dude, this is not better than California with how nice people are and everything. And people are like, don't California my Texas. I don't know if so far people, you know, politeness has been better than California. But this is a very limited experience that I've had so far. I'm sure in Austin, people are great. And just the more I branch out in defense, you know, I went there on a Friday afternoon too. Costco and it was packed. So people are like, keep it moving, pimping, you know, and I respect it. What was crazy is yesterday, because we're still moving in and everything, we haven't really done full grocery shopping and all that. We just been eating out at night and trying to find a restaurant open on Sunday night on Easter in the Bible Belt. Holy shit. That was an experience in itself. Everywhere I called was closed. Every restaurant. We had to drive around just looking for some place with an open sign. And I found one, went in there. No one's wearing masks. All right, cool. I guess we're in Texas. And there's only two people at the bar, no one in the restaurant. Just completely dead. I went out in the parking lot. There's just, other than the two cars that were in there, one other car in a parking lot that could hold like a shopping center, like a car. It could probably hold like 3,000 cars. There was one other car besides ours, other than the two in the bar. But people take their Jesus serious around here. Okay. In the Bible Belt, they'll make you repent. I got to be careful with my goddamns and how loud I say them. I'm going to wake up in the morning. There's going to be a goddamn cross on the lawn, you know, burning, flaming cross. And they're going to be sprinkling holy water on me. Probably need it, you know? But that was an experience, man. There's nothing like that in California with all them devil worshipers, okay? A lot of devil worshipers, apparently. They don't take Easter too serious over there. But I can't believe I saw an armadillo. I was also happy. I don't know. When I first, I came to Texas in like 2017, and I was like in a different part of Texas. I was like outside of Dallas and Arlington. And driving through El Paso, I got my first and only speeding ticket I've ever gotten. I don't know if you know this about me, but your boy, drive like a grandma. I'm just like, what's the rush? You know, I just want to get there safely, and I just don't want to pay a ticket because I cringe thinking about speeding tickets. And when I was driving through El Paso the first time, they rolled up on me. I remember seeing a truck behind me, and I was like, what is that truck doing? And then I see lights on the truck, and I'm like, oh, God damn it, that's a cop. And then I looked down at my speedometer, and I was going like 85 or something like that. And I'm like, oh, shit. And I think the speed limit was like 70 or 75 there. And yeah, there's parts of driving to Texas where the speed limit was 75. So I just keep it around 80, baby, you know? And I pull over, the truck pulls me over. And then he just goes, he sees, of course, my California plates. And he just goes, how you doing, man? He's wearing a cowboy hat. And I'm like, oh, I'm definitely fucked. Man, from around here, huh? Nah, man, I'm just driving through. Okay. And he's just walking around my Corolla, them California plates. I knew I was fucked. And he goes, me and my partner. He nods to the guy on the other side holding his gun. It's like a six shooter. I'm like, all right, I'm definitely dying. Me and my partner here, we clocked you at about 94. You going that fast? And I was like, whoa, no. I was like, I'll be honest with you. I've been going the speed limit this whole time. If it got away from me, I apologize. But, you know, I don't think I was going that fast. Well, to be able to catch up to you, we had to be going about, you know, we got up to like 95 to catch up to you. And I'm just like, I don't, you know, I do apologize. I don't have an exact, you know, the speed limit of when you caught up to me. But I just don't think I was going that fast. And if I did, man, I really didn't mean to. And he goes, okay. And then he goes back to his truck. They come back a little bit later, and I'm just like, fuck. And he has a ticket. And then he wrote on the ticket that I was going 94. And I was like, that's horseshit. But then I go, do you have the radar? Am I able to? No, we got it off of having to catch up to you. So they didn't even have me on radar. They just had me on, I don't know, they fucking eyeballed me apparently. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, you drive safe now. Take care. And then they left. And it was like a $500 or $600 ticket. And then basically on the ticket, this is, I hate this. On a ticket, it said, I had to call the El Paso place on the back to pay the ticket, or else there'd be like a warrant out for my arrest. Okay, that sounds real serious. And in hindsight, I should have just never called, but I kept having the call, and they were like, oh, the ticket wasn't submitted, or they haven't processed it yet. Call back next week. I kept calling back, and it was something like you had to do this for like 60 days. And then if after 60 days, you could have it dismissed. So I keep calling, and then finally, and the lady keeps saying like she knew me every week, because she would be like, ah, they didn't process. They might have lost it. And then I was like, okay, cool. And then on the last day, she goes, okay, well, like, you know, call to get it dismissed so it never comes back to you in the future. And I'm like, okay, cool. So then I call on the day of the dismissal. And then she goes, okay, what was your license number? And then I go, oh, okay. I give her my license number to get it dismissed. And then she goes, oh, hold on. Oh, it is here. They just misspelled your license number. And then I was like, wait, what? Yeah, they wrote your license number different, but I found it. And I'm just like, wait, what do you mean? And then she was like, yeah, you have to pay this. And it's been here. And then I'm like, wait, so if I had just not given you my license number right now, I wouldn't have had to pay it. Yeah, but you know. And then I felt so stupid because I was like, I tried to do the right thing. I'm trying to call to get it dismissed. If I just hadn't called, would have never had to pay that goddamn ticket. And it was like 500, 600 bucks. But anyway, the good news, listen, the good news, didn't get a ticket this time. Was very careful. I even remember the turn where I got the ticket and I just made sure I kept it. I kept it real right. Co-pilot would announce to me when a speed limit would change. She'd be like, the speed limit is now 65. I'm like, thank you, CP. And I'd adjust accordingly. But overall, great trip. I'm very excited about Tejas. I'm excited to start getting into stand-up. Obviously, I've been writing. I did just one gig recently. And I'm going to start looking for spots this week. Listen, your boy is drained, okay? There's something about that drive and like the preparation of moving for a month and then like the come down of like once you're here, your body's just like, ugh. And just getting adjusted to everything. Moving is no joke, especially cross states. But no excuse. That's life, baby. You know, you just got to keep it moving. I feel lucky to be here. We went by a property where the house is going to be built, and that's like a surreal experience to just be like, holy shit, I'm going to have a house here. I'm going to have a house. That's just one of the things I didn't fathom. It's weird when you're growing up that you're just like I never could picture myself with a regular job. And even like the idea, like it's like in the past few years, I've always been like, man, there's such a bridge I have to cross to be able to afford a house. Something nuts is going to have to happen. But like timing was good. I had a great year with business and Texas came along. It was all just, it all came to fruition like at the perfect time. And I'm like, we out here, you know, we out here. We feel blessed. Hashtag blessed, baby. But enough about me, huh? There's crazy shit happening. I thought this was just funny. I wrote it down. This fugitive mafia guy, he's been on the run. And he got caught because he started posting YouTube cooking videos. And that's how they caught him. Was through these YouTube cooking videos. This dude is so Italian that he couldn't help himself from showing his cooking skills. He's how also, like I just picture a guy from The Sopranos. How could you just be like, yeah, this is a good idea. Let me just showcase my cooking skills while I'm on the run as a fugitive. Do you think that's a stereotype where it's like people who are looking for people on the run, they look at their nationality and they're like, this dude's Italian. So we need to start looking at Italian cooking videos on YouTube. They can't help it. They're such showmen. Italians don't hide out too well. You know, they always got to talk loud and the food especially. So they just two and two together and they got them. Some sad news. I saw that, dude, fucking DMX. DMX is in critical care. This is a bummer. There's some celebrities and musicians that when I see them in trouble, it hurts my heart. And DMX is one of those. I have been listening to DMX since I was a little kid. And when I say a little kid, I mean like 5-6 years old. I should have had better supervision. Okay. Listening to DMX. Rough Riders. If you haven't listened to the Damien trilogy of songs by DMX, Slippin', listen to Damien 1, 2, and 3. So many bangers. There is no one else like DMX. The truth, the poetry. He is somebody that has transcended the art form of hip-hop and lyrics. in such a poetic way, but always been someone who has had such demons and always been fighting them. And I hope, man, like I always hear, you know, throughout the years of DMX struggling with, you know, addiction and stuff like that. And I'm always rooting for DMX. His music, man, his music is some of the greatest workout music I've ever listened to. The Hard Times, everything. I've always loved his prayers. While I've never, you know, when I was younger, I was a bit religious, but like I've never been super religious. But there's something about, if you haven't looked him up, look up DMX prayers. I don't know if you have to put DMX prayers skits, but it's like you might find some weird stuff if you had skits. But DMX would just do these acapella reverb prayers on his albums that would be like a minute long, and he would just be praying to God, and it would be like just the dopest shit ever. I wonder if I could play one. I don't know if we're gonna get kicked off YouTube, but they're just so dope. Let me see what we got here.
First, I thank you for the life of everyone that's here with.
No, that's not the one we want. We want the produced one. Oh, and we're kicked off YouTube, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see what we got.
I come to you hungry and tired. You give me food, let me sleep. I come to you weak. You give me strength, and that's deep. You call me a sheep and lead me to green pastures. Only asking that I keep the focus in between the chapters. You give me the word and only ask that I interpret and give me the eyes that I may recognize a serpent. You know I ain't perfect, but you'd like me to try. Unlike the devil who just wants me to lie till I die. Lord, why is it that I go through so much pain? All I saw was black. All I felt was rain. I come to you because it's you who knows. Show me that everything was black because my eyes were closed. You gave me the light and let me bask in your glory. So it was only right that when you asked for this story, I put it together to do our dogs some good. Our dogs being brothers and sisters in the hood.
Bars, ladies and gentlemen. Bars. DMX bars. You really got to go listen to them. If you want to listen to all of them, you can go to YouTube, type in DMX prayer 1-5. Okay? You're going to get some bars. You kind of got to listen to headphones. What's funny is like when I was a kid, like 11 years old, I would play DMX in my headphones before like I was going to compete in anything, any sporting event. And I'd just be listening to DMX. And it's so dope. The way DMX does his prayers is he's just like, Lord, listen now, because I need you to hear me. When I was lost, you're the only one that could believe me. And if it wasn't for you, Lord, I would have passed away. But because of your light is why I stand today. Bars. That was original Evan Lopez prayer. But just his style of talking, his voice. If you ever watch an interview with DMX, he literally talks just like he raps. And he's like, now, Jimmy Kimmel, here I am today. Wondering, what you got me to say? And if you haven't, ladies and gentlemen, I have a friend who we send each other DMX singing Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer every single year. That's a treat. If you haven't seen it, Google Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, DMX. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Welcome to the Puerto Rican Texas Pigeon episode, okay? And remember, no matter what, listen, this podcast is just going to keep going, baby. Every Monday, every Wednesday, until we decide to switch the schedule or something happens, okay? It's just going to keep getting better. And everybody who stuck with me in California, you stick with me in Texas. And who knows where the fuck we're going next. I know Elon Musk lives in Austin now. He wants me to go to Mars. We'll be the first goddamn Martian podcast. I'm ready for it, okay? Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and I will see you on Wednesday. Remember, no matter what, I still love you.